But Sister Smith was asking this morning if she could sing this selection, right? Okay, I'm making sure we're still on the same sheet. Sister Smith was wanting to bless us with the selection on this morning, but of course, God's the blood never loses power. Of course, you know, it's kind of reminiscent of the tithe box, but the blood of the Lamb, the soul cleansing power, look at that, with grace, washes white as snow. So in essence, if tithe can do all that, Jesus' blood is even better.
It's not necessarily in the blood where we get our power.
Correct.
To do what we do, but it's in the act that was done on the cross, the shedding of the blood.
Amen.
And we know the Holy Spirit is the one who gives us the power to do all that we do, but we're still thankful that Jesus shed his blood, thereby giving us the right to be filled with his Spirit so that we can have power.
Amen.
To do all he's called us to do. So we're going to sing it a cappella, and then will you put the words up or no? Well, if you know the words when we get to the chorus, you're welcome to join
okay.
in. We've sung this one before.
Yeah.
The blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. It soothes my doubts and calms my fears, and it dries all my tears. Oh, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. And thank God, it reaches to the highest mountain. Oh, and it flows from day to day, it will never lose its power. And thank God, it reaches to the highest mountain. Yes, it does. And it flows
for Jesus, and that Jesus was willing to come from heaven down and shed his precious blood for you and I, and even for others who don't care and don't care to know about Jesus. This morning, of course, now time for our preached word. Last week, you'll recall, we came from the book of Hosea, chapter 1. We talked about an unfaithful people on last week, and I had challenged myself to read the entire book of Hosea this week, because it's only 13 chapters, and We want to kind of get to the end, the rest of the story. And in going through that, God brought us another message. So we'll be back in Hosea again today. This time we'll be three chapters forward in chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Hosea 4, 1 through 6. Understanding now, as you find that passage scripture, last week we discussed that God gave Hosea a marriage to a lady named Gomer. And his marriage was to be a picture of the rebellion and whoredom or harlotry that Israel had committed against God, right? Yeah. Her father, her savior. Israel, once delivered from Pharaoh's Egypt, went out and they did what? The golden calf. And then they did this and did that. And then the Bible even says they loved flagon, you know, the little raisin cakes from idol gods, all this other type of stuff. They did. They played the harlot after other gods. They left their first love. They left God and went after the God of these people who were around them. And God didn't appreciate that. So God let Hosea know, in your marriage, you're going to get the people are going to see, and you will see a picture of how Israel has treated me. And then in chapter 3, God told Hosea, go and get your wife. The woman, you know, his wife, he had to go and pay for her. And the price he paid you all was 15 pieces of silver and a homer and a half of barley. Now, just so that you know, back during those times, a slave was sold for 30 pieces of silver. So in essence, look at how low his wife had fallen. She wasn't even worth what you'd pay for a slave. 15 pieces, and then a homer and a half of barley. That's grain. That's what you give that ox and that donkey. We read, that's what you feed an animal. That's what he paid to get his own wife back. And if the Bible told him, God says, go and get the wife, your wife of whoredom. You know, this wife, this woman has run off and done this. God still told him, go and love her and get her back. A beautiful picture showing us that when we find ourselves as unfaithful people, yeah, right, God will do what? He'll come out and seek us out. That's what he did with Jesus. Mm-hmm. We were a lost people, an unfaithful people. And God sent Jesus. Jesus redeemed or bought us what? Back. We already belonged to God. Right? God formed us. In Genesis, we read that. So we already belonged to him, but he went and bought us back. Now this morning, Hosea chapter 4, verses 1 through 6 begins now. The Lord has a problem with the people of Israel, and here it is. Hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel. For the Lord hath a controversy, or a charge against you, with the inhabitants of the land. Because why? There is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God in the land. Such a sad thing. Somebody hasn't been telling the story. Look, by swearing and lying and killing and stealing and committing adultery, they break out, or they break all restraints, and blood toucheth blood. There's so much bloodshed that it's running, right? Now, just chapter that verse 2 right there, you can turn on channel 2. You know, WSB TV, to hear that same kind of stuff, right? Swearing, lying, killing, stealing. Cut on CBS, whatever you want, Fox 5, Fox 11. Any news you cut on, we get this same sort of thing happening today. Verse 3 says, therefore, or because of this, or for this reason, shall the land mourn. And everyone that dwelleth therein, God leaves nobody out, shall languish or shall waste away with the beasts of the field, with the fowls of heaven, yea, the fishes of the sea also shall be taken away. Yet let no man strive or contend with the priest. Strive nor reprove another, for thy people are as they that strive with the priest. Verse 5, therefore shalt thou fall in the day, and the prophet also shall fall with thee in the night, and I will destroy thy mother. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God. God says, I will also forget thy children. My people are destroyed, verse 6 says, for a lack of knowledge, because they don't know something. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee. This morning, for just a few minutes, like to ask the question, do you know? Do you know? Personal question. Do you know? A few years ago, many of you all may remember or know of this young lady. She's not a young lady now, but a singer named Miss Diana Ross was in a movie called Mahogany back in 1975. And one of the themes for that movie was a little song that says, do you know? And Diana Ross would come along in her little trademark sound, do you know? In her little high voice. Where are you going to? All that little stuff like that, right? And The opening lyrics of the song says, do you know where you're going to? Do you like the things that life is showing you? And she says, where are you going to? Do you know? She says, do you get what you're hoping for? What you look, when you look behind you, there's no open doors. What are you hoping for? But the first statement of that song says, do you know? And then she says, where are you going to? The question this morning, we as believers should know where we're going to, but people out in the world don't understand exactly where they're going. Somebody said, yeah, I know I'm going to, man. I'm in my car. I'm finna go to the game. The Braves playing there. No, no, brother. I'm not talking about that destination. Well, no, young man, I'm on my way to Kroger. I got to get me some fat meat to go in my car. No, sister, I'm not talking about that destination. Do you know where you're going to? Do you know where your soul is going to end up? Do you know Jesus on this morning? God says, I have a controversy or a problem with my people because they don't know me. He said, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge or lack of knowing.
Yeah.
Our world today is being destroyed, and we're going, as they would say, to that proverbial hell in the handbasket because people have no knowledge or respect or reverence or fear of God.
Yes, they really don't.
So the question God is posing to his people this morning is, do you know, have you all forgotten on this morning? Do you know is the question we want to ask for just a few moments on this morning. We're looking at Hosea 4, 1 through 6. Hosea 4 and 1 says, hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel. First thing is we got to hear, we have to be listening for the word of God, listening for the voice of God, right? It says, hear the word of the Lord, ye children of Israel, for the Lord hath a controversy with the inhabitants of the land, because there is no truth, nor mercy, nor knowledge of God. The first thing God says is there is no truth. If you don't know God, there can be no truth. The Bible tells us that God is not a man that he should lie. So God is truth. The Bible also tells us in the New Testament that God is love. God is truth. In our world today, so many people fall from grace or from whatever because of lies. And that second verse, swearing and lying and this, that, and the other, I didn't do that. I didn't smoke that. I didn't hit her. Truth be told, well, yeah, see, what had happened was I didn't want to because you did it. You lied. There's no truth there. So God says, I have a problem, first of all, because there's no truth. And ultimately, God is speaking of that truth that comes in. But I can imagine a people now, Israelite, people who are lying to themselves. When they would say, this be the God that brought us, and we want to do this, there is no truth. You and I can't rely on what the government would per se offer us, what we would read in a textbook or an encyclopedia or Hello 2013 on Wikipedia. We can't believe in those sorts of truths.
Yeah.
So gentleman I was talking, not talking to, a gentleman who was speaking to us on yesterday, my son and I were down at Hyatt Regency downtown, and Ambassador Andrew Young was there speaking, and it was interesting to note when he talked about college, he was talking to high school students, such as my son and other college students, saying the things that I learned back when he was, he said, I already have been disproved. You know, what he was taught as a truth and what he took a test over in college, they disproved that or it's changed or this, that, and the other. Give us long enough time here on earth and that's what happens, right? Before we knew about electrons and protons and neutrons, you know, the little small things we can't see, we just said it was whatever. Then when man got a microscope and could magnify and go down and look, we saw what cells are made up and that we're made up of cells and that, oh, our blood looks red, but it's actually white blood cell, all this other type of stuff. If you give us a little time, right? Our truths change. God's truth is always the same.
Yes.
So the first problem God has is that there is no truth. Then he says, nor is there mercy. Everybody wants to hold everybody else accountable, but I don't want to be held accountable myself. You know, when Robert get in trouble, I want some mercy. Come on now. When a police officer stopped me for speeding, I want him to give me a warning, Miss Christine. I don't want the ticket. I want some what? I want some mercy.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to give State Farm any more money. You know, that little man on TV, are you in good hands? I want to be in good hands. I want a piece of the rock. I want to save 15% in 15 minutes. You know what I'm saying? I want a break. Show me some mercy, Mr. or Mrs. Officer of the Law. They can do that, right? It's totally up to them, man. They can decide to give, well, young man, I'm going to give you a warning. Oh, thank you so much, smiling. Yes, sir. Look at that. Yes, miss, whatever they name it. Boy, you just get all friends or showing them every tooth and every one you ain't got. You just smiling. Oh, thank you so much. And so much so, sometimes we wait till they leave before we pull off. We're like, oh, thank you, Lord. Let them go ahead and pull off. Hit our blanket. We do everything right now. Hit our blanket, Miss Christine. Checking mirrors. All that stuff. We remember. Come on now. You remember back in driving. You're doing all them things now. You're like, yeah, you get in traffic and signal your intentions. Have a good day because somebody showed you some mercy. God says, here around you, there's no truth, nor is there any mercy? Nobody wants to give anyone any mercy. Understanding now that God does chasten and punish us when we do wrong, but with all of that, God gives mercy. With parents, and even sometimes on our jobs, our bosses and those we work with can show us mercy. You know, Robert, you made this mistake. I'm going to just talk to you about it, son, instead of writing this thing down. You and I can handle it. We'll be all right. It's all good. We don't have to put this in your folder. We're going to talk about it. It shouldn't happen again. Thank you, Mr. and Mrs. Boss. Thank you, so forth and so on. Let's move on with it. God said there is no mercy. What happens to a people who don't know God? No truth, nor is there any mercy. Everyone out for what they can get from somebody else, Ms. Sheila. I got it. You want to give it to me. I ain't showing you no mercy. It's a dog-eat-dog world. We talk about being a cutthroat society. Everybody wants what they can get from somebody else. No one wants to show anyone any mercy. You drive down the street and there's that woman, single lady. You see that child sitting in the back of her car smoking. And no mercy. She should have a cell phone. Everybody got one now. And drive off. You know, we do those little things. We assume things like that. You know, well, I don't have time with it. If that was your dog, if that was your wife with one of your children on the side of 75, come on now, where folks are getting killed daily, changing tires. Come on now. Somebody's car break down. They got the gas can in their hand walking. Somebody not paying attention coming, kills them. Dead. Young man who skateboard goes out the street, runs out to get it early one morning. That young man is dead, never made it to school. Right here in Georgia. Right? Those sorts of things. But there's no mercy. There's no truth. No one cares for anybody else. It's all about me. Right? Me, myself, and I. No mercy. Then lastly, God says, nor knowledge of God in the land. What a charge. You know, when God says God has a contract, God has a charge against. You know, imagine, this is God presenting his case. Your Honor, I would like to say this, God, I would like to say there is no truth, no mercy. And then God said, you don't even know me. There's no knowledge of me in this land. We've lost knowledge for God today. More Bibles printed. Miss Becky, you can get Bibles anywhere. You know, folk go, come on now, go to the hotel, steal them. Or steal. Take those, girls, they want you to get them. Those Gideon, you know, Bibles just about everywhere. On my phone right now, I got Bruce Moses, but I got three different Bible apps. I got olive trees, something. I can get to the word when I'm doing Spanish. I give me a Spanish and English side by side. I can look at all this sort of access we can have to have a knowledge of God. Churches have Bible studies on Wednesdays. We have ours on Tuesdays. Somebody have it on this day. Well, I can't make it because I work it. I guarantee you, whatever day you can make it, somebody somewhere has a decent Bible study so you can get to know about God. But God said there is no knowledge of me where? In this land. When people would say, I want this taken off that dollar bill. But folks will say, brother, you can't carry that cross around because it's a weapon. No knowledge of God in the land. So what do we have there? God said swearing, lying, killing, stealing, committing adultery. They break out and blood touches blood. I would ask us, how do we get to a point like that? How do we get to a place where there's no knowledge of God in the land and where nobody knows him and this, that, and the other? I'll tell you how it is. The scripture tells us. In Judges chapter 2 and 10, the Bible says it like this. And also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation, guess what, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. Someone stopped sharing the story. That's how we get there. Yes. People don't know about God because those of us who are supposed to know aren't telling them anything. Guess what? It's not always with our words. Well, Brother Robert, that ain't fair because my uncle is deaf and he can't talk. How he gonna share? How does your uncle live? Come on now. It's not always about what I say to shit. Brother Robert can show up, put some words together, and talk too fast most of the time. But how does your life live for other people? How do you treat your family? How do you treat that person in Walmart in front of the line? How do you treat that one getting gas who pulled in the wrong way and you want to cuss them because they car headed this way and you trying to get to the pump and you just, well, backing up and going around? You know, how do people see you react? But the Bible here says in Judges 2 and 10, there arose a generation that knew not. All the older saints had gone off the scene. There arose a generation that knew not God. Said not only did they not know him, Miss Christine, they didn't even know what he had done. Somebody stopped saying, yeah, and he brought us through the Red Sea. And, oh, he brought us through the Jordan River. And, well, when we got bit by the serpent, somebody stopped sharing their story. That's how we get to a point where we have a nation full of swearers, liars, killers, thieves, adulterers, a people who have no knowledge of God. Because those of us, we're accountable. Those of us who know don't share the story. So many ways to do it. We put our little prayer list on our website every week. I don't know how many people look at it, but it lets somebody know we're praying for somebody what? Besides us. Pray for my pastor. Pray for the first. There's folks out there going to hell. Please, I can pray for myself. Pray for that one that don't know Jesus. Pray for that one that's broken to somebody's heart. Come on now, in Job, a 92-year-old breaking this. Pray for the one who's doing that kind of stuff. Because they're going to come into the wrong person's house. To happen just last week also, somebody's going to have something waiting for them. And somebody's going to lose their life over some stuff they had no business going to somebody's house to get. Anyway. That's the one you pray for. It's not always about us. We have a great commission praying for folks over in other countries. Yeah, it's bad here in America, but man, they locking folks up. We haven't got there yet. They locking folks up, won't let them come home to see their babies for naming the name. We haven't got there yet. Pray for those people. It's not always about it. Tell and share the story. That's a way of getting the message out all over the world. If you Twitter, tweet it. If you Facebook it, whatever. Let folks know about Jesus. And like I said, it's not always with words. How do you conduct yourself? How is your deportment, as we should say in our church covered every month, being exemplary in our deportment? What that means is the way I conduct and carry myself, Ms. Beck. I'm always Brother Robert. They may not know I'm a pastor, somebody's husband, somebody's dad, but I'm always a Christian. When I take this off, when I get home this afternoon, I ain't got to have a tie on. I ain't got to have a necktie on to say Jesus loves me. Please, I know he loves you. You should know he loves me by the way I treat myself and the way I treat you.
Yes, amen.
Right? For God so loved that he gave. If I love you, I ought to give you something. What? A little bit of my time. Brother, I may not have a whole lot of, you know, this jingling stuff. That's key. May not have a whole lot of that jingling and that paper stuff to give you, but I can give you some love. Come on now. Sister Mickey, cook a plate. We can get a meal in your belly. Come on now. If I love you, I can give you something. A little bit of my time, a little bit of attention.
Yes, yes.
But there arose a generation that knew not the Lord, nor the works of the Lord. Are we sharing? Do you know this one? Are we sharing what God has done for us in our life? Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, Lord, it wasn't me, but I went by the bedside. I forgot to tell y'all, Brother Jeffrey Bradshaw, the second name on our prayer list. Mm-hmm. Told y'all I was going to visit with him last Sunday. Got there last night. I was at the hospital over 3 hours. Long time, longer than I wanted to be. But I waited. Brought that man up to his room. Before I left, y'all, he was talking, even with that trach thing in here. He was coughing on his own. He rolled over and was moving. And the nurses from downstairs, because he had been in critical care, CCU, for over a month. You know, he's looking bad for him. The nurses didn't believe it. Had to come up to the fifth floor, room 571, Fayette Piedmont. Had to come up to the room because they couldn't believe that this man who was laid out all the time was moving. Ain't saying it's got nothing to do with me, but I know we've been praying. I know Miss Vicky asked us to pray for her. We've been praying. I know some other folks been praying for Brother Jeffrey. I was there by his bedside and said, hey, Mr. J, how you doing? Talk to me. Remember me from going to his daddy's funeral when his daddy died. Had prayer with him before I left. And his sister Cassandra and his mother was right there by the bedside. Wonderful thing to see family there wrapping around. Come on now, their loved one. And Miss Vicky told me just this week he's doing much better. Because they moved him from this floor up here. We talked about God exalting. Moved him up to the fifth floor. Eventually, he's going to be coming right on out of Fayette, Piedmont. Back home, he's a wonderful chef. Loved to watch the cooking channel. Totally, why cut the TV on. I want to see that food. And they were wonderful chef. That man can cook. I mean, you know, as we say, can burn. He can get down with it, right? Soul food, this food, that, whatever that. Brother Jeffrey can hook it up. He's ready. God has done something. Tell the story. Like I said, it didn't happen to me, but I know somebody. I saw God move in somebody else's life. I was there. This man, I saw him down in CCU. But now he's up here moving, wanting to turn over, telling me I do it, raise my head, and come told his wife, could you grease my scalp and brush my hair? Concerned about his physical appearance? Come on now. Somebody's coming on around.
Amen.
I was there. Tell and share the story. Yes. That's what our prayer list gives us an opportunity to do. When we pray for folks and God moves, we want to share that.
Yes.
What God said. If God hadn't moved yet, we're still praying. Amen.
Yes.
We want to share the story.
Yes.
And the wonderful works, which they didn't do,
yes,
that God has done. But that's what happened. We don't tell the story. We don't share. We stop living. So people have no knowledge of God. They don't know, as Sister Diana, they don't know where they're going to. They don't know what life is. They don't have no idea. They just live. As Stevie Wonder would say, living just enough for the sake, just trying to make a day. That's sad if all you're trying to make is a day. Now, I understand the Bible tells me I only have today, but Miss Becky, if tomorrow comes, there is something in my cupboard, right? I don't just buy enough cereal for the day, Miss Christine. I buy a gallon of milk when I go to the store, right? Because somebody may want Captain Crunch on Monday, but come Friday, if we still got some, I may want some Captain Crunch then, Miss Sheila. So God gave us this wonderful thing called a refrigerator, where I can put my food in there. Back in the old days, it was an ice box. Amen. It was a box with a big old block of ice on it. Ice man would come down with them big tongs, come in, and that's how you try to keep things fresh. Now we got preservatives and refrigerators. Lord, freeze them. We can freeze stuff for a long time. So we prepare for stuff like that, but do we honestly know where we're going? Have I made those same sort of preparations for my soul?
Yeah.
Am I preparing the way for somebody? Am I trying to guide somebody that doesn't know where they're going to? That's out there in a world full of swearers, liars, thieves, and killers, each and every day. So God says, I have a problem with you because this is what I see in the land. Swearing, lying, killing, stealing, committing adultery. And look, he said, they break out. I mean, just bursting out. Blood touches blood. So God says, I got something for you. Therefore shall the land mourn, and everyone that dwelleth therein shall languish or shall waste away. The beasts of the field, we see that today. People wasting away. You know, you're going to look at some people. Met a young lady, didn't meet her, but saw a young lady yesterday, 15 years old. That girl looked, man, she's a lot older than 15. I don't know what kind of life she's been leading, but I was like, 15? You know, look like a grown woman. It's just sad when you see somebody aging that quick. 15? I mean, 15 and just age. So, and it's all right to be mature in your thinking, but when it just starts happening out here, something's wrong. We're not getting enough rest. We're not taking care of ourselves. But it says the people will waste away. Notice, it says with the beasts of the field, fowls of the heaven, yea, the fishes of the sea also shall be taken away. You do understand that when we talk about, let's go back to elementary science. Anybody remember ecosystem? Remember when the teacher showed you the ant, and then the bug eat the ant, and then the bird eat the dick, and then that, you know, that little circle, right, that ecosystem? You know, we play a role in that, right, as human beings. We're here for a reason, right? God has us as part of what the world would call this ecosystem. The trees produce oxygen. We do what? Breathing in, then we breathe out carbon, and that tree's taking it. All this kind of stuff is happening, right? When the Bible here looks, in chapter 3, it says that we're going to be gone or waste away, and the beasts of the field, but we don't do what we're supposed to do, things happen out in nature as well. When we don't take care and we don't do right, things happen to the animals who what? Who just doing what God told them to do. Right? Animals, lions are still being a lion. They're still roaring. Elephants still have tusks and trunks, right? The elephant ain't come to your house and like, hey, Miss Christine, give me some of them peanuts. Uh-uh. Man, you better stay, you know, you stay where you at, Mr. Babar, Mr. Dumbo. You in the zoo, you should take care of that. They got something for you over there, partner. I have nothing here for you. Right? But they're still doing what they're supposed to do. But all of us, mankind, we want to do what we want to do. We want to take our bodies and do things with them they weren't designed. We want to take our minds and place them on thoughts and dwell on things we shouldn't even be dwelling on. We should be studying this word, sharing this, getting more knowledge of God in so we can do what? Share it with somebody else. Some of us can't share because we don't know anything ourselves. We have nothing to share. Nothing but what the pastor said. That's all right up to a point, but eventually it's got to be personal for you. God has done something for you. Well, your pastor told me about this man. Okay, but eventually, okay, but what has God done for you? Well, see, I saw on TV what, no. What happened when the TV's turned off? What do you have to share? Do you have anything? Is there anything in here? Are you giving God anything to work with? Okay, I expect my wife to prepare some pretty decent meals for us at the house, but she does. But I got to give her something to do with, Miss Christine. Got to make sure some chicken and some, got to make sure something in there. She don't go in there and take paper and fork and just clang plates and say, come and get it. And we eating imaginary food. I mean, that may be cool for Barney, but Brother Robert can't eat no imagination. You know, come on now, I need some ribs and collard. I need some real, something that's going to really fill this pain. Imagination ain't going to do it. That only goes so far, Miss Sheila. And Brother Robert get a real bad understanding when I get home. It's not good for me not to go too long. Now, I can fast, but when it's time to eat, Yeah, I done worked, it's hard, and my belly is on the eat. You know, like the car running on fumes, I'm running on empty. It's time to put a little, give me a cracker or something. I know dinner's going to be 30 minutes, but my patients, they get quite a bit of them saltines. They give me a Ritz or something. You know what Andy Griffith say? That's a good cracker. Boy, when you're hungry, it sure is good, isn't it? That little old something. But God here says what? He says, therefore, the land is going to waste away. Why? Yet let no man strive, nor approve another. For thy people are as they that strive with the priest. Nobody can even say anything to anybody because we're all in this together. Our church today in America, in the West, is little we can say to other people because our churches aren't doing what we need to do. No, we're just participating in the same sort of fooling, swearing and lying going on where? Yes, right in our churches.
That's right.
Pastor, same website God had this morning. Pastor was fired from a church for conducting a same-sex wedding in this church. Why in the world? But the members got rid of him. Amen, membership. You know, that's not the kind of person we want leading us. And if we got something to say about it, brother, you got to go on with that kind of doctrine. Because we don't see anywhere in the world where God would ordain that. I don't know why you did it, but we put you out. And they did. Say, sir, you got to go. But our churches have to stand.
Yeah.
We can't participate and bring everything the world is doing into our churches, expecting it to, you know, we're gonna make it a holy whatever because we put Christian on it, or because it's got a cross on it, or because we put Jesus in it. That don't make it holy. scripturally speaking, can you find foundation for that stuff? Jesus, I believe, whooped some folks, amen, and put them out of the temple for doing things that were contrary to the word of God and with the wrong heart and the wrong spirit of what they were doing. Yes, those people needed animals, but they were highway robbers. They were charging people too much, and they had a captive audience. These people that traveled through the desert for miles and miles needed a sacrifice, couldn't bring their own little animal with them. So I'm going to charge you double for one because we got it right here. Reminds us of convenience stores today.
Right.
Go to Kroger and get some milk, it's $2 or $3. Man, you go to the gas station, $5. It's the same company. What's the difference? They charge you for the convenience.
Right.
That's why it's called a convenience store. Lines generally aren't as long, Miss Christine. It's generally closer to the house. You just want to run in and get it, what? And get out. I ain't got time for them lines and folks. So I'm going to go in and get it. So sometimes you pay for that convenience. But it always got me. Why does that cost so much? When I was a little boy, Mom used to send us to the store back when you could do that. And Mom would need some eggs. You could go to the store, Miss Sheila, by my house and buy one egg.
Right.
The guy had a cart. Oh, yeah. Mom would say, go up and give me a couple of eggs. You could get two eggs out of that. And they would charge, I think, a quarter per egg. And those eggs back then wasn't very expensive. But, you know, convenience. Mama needed something. The store is called the little store, the corner store. What's closer? Take your bike up there, Robin. She called me a little nickname. Anyway, take your bike up there and get Mama's. And I had to get back home with them eggs, too. And I couldn't break them on my bike, Miss Sheila. Because Mama had paid for them. I didn't have a job. So I had to get them two eggs, not a dozen, and get right on back to the house because Mama's doing something she just needed.
Two eggs.
Wow. A little corner store. You can go and get those little things like that. Just look whatever you need, right? But God says, all this away. He says, so don't strive, don't do this. Therefore shalt thou fall, verse 5, in the day, and the prophet also shall fall with thee in the night, and I will destroy thy mother. You're all going together. Verse 6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Why? Because thou hast rejected knowledge. They had it right here, and they did what? Rejected it. How are you going to sit up in a class and the teacher tell you what's going to be on the teacher? Say, I don't believe I am. And just reject it. Okay. You're going to get what they call that little beautiful flag on your paper. And then when you get it home, your parents may have some flag for you. You mean you sat up and did what? She told you 2 plus 2 is 4. You said, no, I think it's what? You're going to reject or not? This woman or this man has been to school, gotten their degree, but you're going to tell it, man, you better sit at that desk and get that, we say, get your lesson. You know, get your learning. But you're going to tell and do it. That's how we look messing with God. God started this whole thing out. You and I were just dust on the ground. He formed us, breathed into us in Genesis. We became a living soul. But we're going to tell God, well, now, God, I think this is bad. I think this is the way we are. And God was here in the beginning. I believe that's what he asked Job. He said, Job, where were you when I hung this stone? Where were you, Job? You fussing around. Job, where were you? Job had said he had to do this. Said Job said he had to do this. Because he still wanted to say something. Say, I could. Sometimes we need to just put a sock in or whatever. Do something. Because we're going to say something we don't need to say. And there again, now, with God, that's still dangerous because he knows my heart anyway. So I can still not say it, but God's still going to get me. The Bible says, so a man thinketh, so he is.
So
I can think even, and God said, yeah, Robert, you didn't put your hand to it. Man, you thought about getting it. Yeah, I saw you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, God said, you had it all played out, how you were going to deck him and do it. Mm-hmm. God's going to get me for that.
Mm-hmm.
Man can only see what we do. But God says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected it, he says, guess what? I'll also reject thee. Thou shalt be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. Not only does it affect us, our society today, our nation much weaker now because, you know, sometimes we didn't pass on some of those things we should have.
Right.
So now it doesn't just affect me. You know, I'm doing something for those coming behind me. Guess what? It's not just my children, right? Because my kids have to deal with somebody else's kids in the world. So what I'm doing is not just for these four here. That would be very selfish of me. That would be very prideful of me to say, oh, just all my kids, My kids are going to have to deal with some of those other kids out there in the world. So it's good that we go out and do other things for some of those other folks in the world to try to share the love of Christ and the light of Christ in some of those dark and desolate lives. It's not just about us. Not just about the church. But a lot of churches, all they're concerned about is building themselves up. What can we do to help us? Every program they do is focused on here. Are you doing anything for anybody in your neighboring community? Do your neighbors even know your name? Do you know their name? Do you ever get out on the street? You know, there again, it's not so much what you say. I don't get to stand on my street corner and give a sermon. I'm a pastor, but when I'm out there, hey, how you doing? Everything, you know, just little things you do, how you act and react to other people. When an opportunity comes, there's a relationship that's built, so they may come to me when they need something. I may not be able to give it, but there's a relationship there. But to not even know and this, what kind of car they drive, who should be at that house and who shouldn't be, little things we do, right? To show someone else, that's mercy. That's taking care and looking after someone else, not being so self-centered. Isaiah also says like this, Isaiah 5:13, therefore my people are gone into captivity because they have no knowledge. They're captive, they're caught up, they're bound because they have no knowledge, Isaiah 5:13, and their honorable men are famished and their are multitudes dried up with thirst. Man, that's where I was going to come from today. The Lord sent me back to Hosea. But when I saw that scripture, the honorable men are famished, starving. Honorable men, you know, they're starved. They're just wasted away. Honorable people. And that's what happens also. Some of those good ones, sometimes we get ourselves or get themselves too drawn out, too this, that, and other. It's so weak that the enemy comes in. They're famished. And then it says the multitude are dried up with thirst. I believe Jesus said he was living water. So if you dried up with thirst as a believer, there's no excuse for me to be thirsty like that.
Yes, right.
Jesus said, I am that living water. Ain't that what he told that woman at the well? He said, I'll give you a drink. You'll never thirst again. You may need some more Dasani, Aquafina, if you're expensive, somebody to feed you water. You may need some of all that. But Jesus said, this water that I give is living water. And you'll never thirst again. But when we become like that and we talk about being famished, we're fed. The Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. That passage we read in John 17, Jesus said, I gave them what? The word you gave me. I made known all to them. That's what Jesus fed them. It wasn't about the fish they had after he was resurrected and the drought that they poured. It wasn't about that and the five, oh please. They ate that and had to do what? Had to eat again. Right? This is it. But the honorable men, the leaders, our church, the honorable people, families, we're tired out. Why? Sometimes doing too much. Doing things we have no business doing. Instead of telling the story, we run to do this, run to that, trying to have her and do her. And God ain't told us to bid more have her or do her. There's somebody else out there to do that.
Right.
Some of the even organizations even have to be done in the church sometimes. But we want to bring it in, like I say, put that holy spin on it because it makes us feel good. There's nothing wrong with doing that. Do what you need to do for God. Then go out there and join an organization and help them. If that's how you want to help, go and do that. But don't have to, let's make it a church that you want to lump everybody up. Maybe because of what God told you to do. You go do it. When God told Hosea what to do, he said, okay, now every one of us now, I'm going to get some more of y'all property. We're going to go and get us, you go and marry a woman. He didn't include everybody else. Because like I said, if he had told me to go do a what, is she going to do who? I don't think so. And then I'm going to have to go pay for what? God knowing I'm cheap anyway. I would have had, Lord forbid, I would have been one of the stories. And Brother Robert walked with y'all would have heard, you know, in the scripture, and he was disobedient, and God would have had to whoop me. Because I would have been, Lord, that's, man, that's tough. That's where the rubber meets the road. That's real obedience. That's some do you know. He said, brother, son, do you know? I'm like, Lord, I don't know. I don't think so. So he says my people are destroyed. Isaiah says they're held captive. And that's what happens. Our churches, our Christians, as believers, we're locked down because we reject it and because we don't know. Don't understand the power that God has given us. The authority that is God given. Not authority like I go, I'm the preacher. And I said, not that kind of, not that ignorant type of authority. An authority and a boldness that I can walk in because I am a child of the King, not a King, of the King. Why? King of Kings, Lord of Lord. I am His child.
Yes.
I'm a joint heir with His Son Jesus,
yes,
who came and walked this world. Do you know, brother? Yeah, I know, Lord, where I'm on my way to. But on the way, I'm gonna share some knowledge. Why? So there won't be a generation, not just of these, but those who come behind. They never heard, nor do they knew, and it's gonna be whose fault? They can't know unless we tell them. Unless we show them, because a lot of times, unfortunately, some families, all a child will get is what? This read to them. But yeah, that's what he say, you better do it. Then their mom and daddy going to do whatever they want
right
to.
Exactly.
You know? But we need to tell and show. Show and tell like in school? That's what we need to do.
Yeah.
So we can answer the question. Do you know? Yeah, Lord, I know where I'm on my way to. Mm-hmm. And I know that I live in a land of people who swear and who lie. But Lord, I want to be one of those that comes. I don't want to have, want you to have a charge against me, Father, for not doing what I'm supposed to. I don't want to be, like you said last week, an unfaithful people. I want to be a faithful son. I want to be a faithful steward, God, over what you've given.
Yes.
And I want to understand, and guess what? I know where I'm going to what, and I can help somebody else along the way. Right? Lord forbid, you know, man, do you know how to get to, well, let me pull out, let me see. No. Well, I think it, no, you thinking, that's okay. Appreciate you. Got a willing spirit, but don't get more know where I'm going. How do you get to, let me find somebody who can get me where I need to. Do you know? Sometimes we can't even understand it. Tell them. Because we have not the knowledge that we should have. And able to share it with somebody else. Last and final verse I'm going to share with you. We're going to go home. If you would, just in your Bible, let's go to Jude. Jude only has one chapter. So it's just Jude verse 10. So Jude only has one chapter. So it won't be Jude 1. It's just Jude 10. Right. Interesting enough. Now we talk about, I looked a little bit at God's sense of humor when he talked about the ox and the donkey. And look here, it's so wonderful how God's word is reading. Look at what Jude says in Jude 10. Now, at the beginning, I'm just going to read to you really quickly. Jude verse 4 says, certain men have crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus. Some folks have come in with some bad knowledge, with some false information. And notice what Jude says here in Jude 10. He says, look, but these speak evil of those things that they do not know. When we asked this morning, do you know? They speak about stuff they don't know. Look, but what they know naturally. God is not natural. The Bible says they that worship him must worship him in spirit. And to have nothing to do with the natural side. What they know naturally, look, as brute beasts. Remember that old ox and that donkey? As brute beasts, in those things, they corrupt themselves. That's what they act like animals. Brute beasts. Don't bid more know we're trying to share something with somebody. How would you like a bull come on trying to tell you how to eat your hamburger? I'm like, man, you better get out of here. I'm going to shred you. Brother, you're going to end up in Burger King. You keep on. No, you the meat. You the meat sore. You're going to come tell me something. But say they act like brute beasts. Don't bid more know. Out of their natural and carnal minds, trying to share stuff, and it sounds good sometimes.
Right.
Sometimes you even see some of those books in your family Christians, in your life ways, and on your CBD.com, or just somebody natural, whatever, telling, but never a bit of scripture in there. The principles sound good, but show me where that's founded in scripture. We're talking about a knowledge. I need something I can share with somebody else. I don't just want to share a story. Stories change. Because somebody else may go through that same situation you went through, it didn't turn out that way. I need some real truth that's found here. In the Word of God. That's a nice story. That's something great. May make a great Hallmark movie. You know what I'm saying? One of them, what they call a tearjerker. Got you in a theater, you just crying. Oh, that's so, ooh, yeah. But anyway, come on. And the foundation, where's that in the scripture? Can you help a brother out? Where is that? He says, like brute beasts. Look at that. And things, they corrupt themselves. Speaking evil of those things which they know not. They don't even know. They don't know, but as believers, we should know. So the question is asked is, do you know? Do we understand? Diana Ross asked us, do you know where you're going to? Yes, Lord, I know. I understand what life is showing me. Sometimes when I don't, Miss Becky, I understand I may be in that Hosea situation where God is taking my life and opening it up for somebody else to see. I may be a picture of something. God is trying to get the cross of somebody else. Had nothing to do with me. But I understand that when I do that, I'm going with God. And as I go, I'm going to share the knowledge with somebody else. I don't want a generation to come up behind me that doesn't know it. And people destroyed for lack of knowledge. Some of us today, I was talking to somebody the other day, had an electronic device. They didn't know how to operate fully. And because they didn't, they, well, here, won't you? But what happens, eventually what happens when that person's off the scene? I have some relatives right now, back in Texas, that will call me for stuff because they just never bothered to learn for themselves. And that's part of that my fault, probably. But when you're a little kid, Ms. Beck, and somebody asks you to do something, it's, oh, I can show, yeah. And when you grow up where people are always coming to you, you get kind of, you know, all right, but pretty soon, you know, when you old and 40-something years old and got a family and 4 and 5 people demand on, you don't have time to sit and tell them how to program their visa. Well, can't you? I'm 900 miles away. You mean you can't? Well, you just made the mission story today. I don't know.
Yeah.
And they ain't got Netflix, Miss Christine. They can't go watch it on TV. They don't have a computer. So how you go? Destroyed for lack of knowledge. Sometimes we just want the easy way out. Can you show me? Can you? I got to get in here.
Me too.
No. Scripture tells us, 2 Timothy 2:15, study to do what? Show yourself approved. Nothing wrong with a sister. But what happens when, I forget his name, Pastor Alvin, his wife, I think it's Nagma, but imagine Sister Nagma and those kids, if there wasn't something there, where that woman would be? Her husband had gone over a year.
Right.
But obviously she knows there's a foundation where she's still standing strong.
Amen.
Come on now. She can't, because she didn't know her husband was going to be taken away. But I'm sure her husband, while he was there and he was teaching about Christ, I'm sure he made it real what? To his own family. Otherwise, his wife would probably be on new cussing and da-da. They need to get my black husband. America ain't doing blah, 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 nothing, da-da. But what is she doing? She went to the United Nations, conducted herself professionally. Yes, she was a wife. She's missing her husband. Talked to our government. Senator Kerry has made a second request saying, please release this man. Come on now. She's working it the right way. There's something there. But it's sad that. So our question we ask this morning is indeed, do you know? And with that, we need to know Jesus. So in asking that question, we says now, we say, behold the Lamb, John 1:29, which says what?
The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of